strange document written in 1960 but not made public till over half a century later. A small clue, the author was mentioned in Ruth's talk. Here's the quotation. "It is painful for me to have to write the following lines. I cannot conceive of writing my autobiography. It seems to me that those who can do so are those who have led purely public and exterior lives, or those who can successfully conceal from themselves what they prefer not to know about themselves." Well, those striking words are from the peculiarly defensive statement which T.S. Eliot left in a sealed envelope with his executors in the 1960s, I said, in the knowledge that Emily Hale had deposited with Princeton University Library a large cache, indeed well over a thousand, of the love letters, mostly love letters, which he'd written to her in the 1930s and 1940s. Some of you, I'm sure, will have read the press coverage when the letters were made publicly available by Princeton in January 2020. But for anyone who didn't and is interested, all the letters, together with Eliot's statement, are now freely available, beautifully edited, on the T.S. Eliot Foundation website. Whatever one makes of Eliot's attempt to send a message to posterity about how to interpret the epistolary remains, well, on his side anyway, because he destroyed Emily Hale's letters, of his relationship with Emily Hale, you'll appreciate why I've picked out for present purposes the opening of Eliot's statement. With its claim not only that writing an autobiography was inconceivable for someone of his own highly tortured character, but that the only people who can write an autobiography are either those who've led purely public lives and therefore by implication have nothing truly personal to disclose, or those capable of a kind of self-deception. What Eliot's carefully crafted formulation, with its double dichotomy of public, private, and truth concealment, seems not to envisage is the possibility of an autobiography which positively chooses to lay bare, unflinchingly, even the most intimate parts of the author's life. Eliot, we can safely assume, would have been appalled by marginal comment. Although Eliot's perspective on the nature of autobiography betrays his own complicated sense of self, it isn't a point of view unique to him. Consider briefly another quotation on the subject, this one from an academic, a statement which bears remarkable similarity, actually, to Eliot's, with one important difference. Here's this quotation. "I cannot imagine trying to write an intellectual autobiography myself. It's a genre of which I'm suspicious. I'm suspicious because I certainly think I would find it impossible to be sure about how I came to hold my present beliefs. But it would also be likely to be self-deceiving. There would be elements of vanity which I wouldn't be aware of. The genre of autobiography, I think, is a kind of guarantee of putting self-deception on display." Be warned. Well, those sentiments are from an online interview with the renowned Cambridge historian of ideas, Quentin Skinner, published only just this past January. And the sentiments, as I say, so similar to Eliot's, one wonders whether at least subliminally Skinner had read that Eliot statement when it got publicised and had it at the back of his mind. Be that as it may, I don't myself quite agree with Eliot the poet and Skinner the scholar that autobiography is inescapably self-deceiving. One could argue the point at length, of course, but I prefer to qualify that categorical judgment with a more delicate distinction between autobiographers who believe they can make sense of their own lives and those who, most famously in the case of Augustine's Confessions, find that they are a mystery and an enigma to themselves. Well, Kenneth Dover was not in any sense an Augustinian figure. He did think that within certain pragmatic limits he could make sense of the life he'd led. But that doesn't make his memoir a wholly transparent exercise. Indeed, it generates complexities and paradoxes of its own. In the first place, although Dover's entire career was spent in academia, he didn't think of marginal comment and he didn't want other people to think of it as an academic autobiography, that phrase in inverted commas. He took exception indeed to that very phrase in one of the reader's reports when the book eventually rejected by Oxford University Press in 1994. His reason was that, as he put it, academics are non-academics for a large part of their waking lives. In other words, he wanted his book to deal with the whole gamut of his experience, including the entanglement between personal and professional factors in the fabric of his life. How far Dover succeeded in illuminating the interaction of the personal and professional is open to judgment. Mary Beard, for example, reviewing the memoir in the London Review of Books, the original edition in 1994, or her review was early 95, I think, found it disappointing in this respect. But I think that she was especially looking for insight into how Dover's work had affected the rest of his life, whereas Dover himself was chiefly, though not exclusively, concerned with the opposite direction of influence from the life to the work. And in that regard, I do think that the memoir cumulatively, as well as in several telling respects, builds up a coherent picture of how the matrix of Dover's life experiences in the round helped to form both his personality and his scholarship. In the broader terms, there is, for one thing, a clear correlation, even a causal connection, between the sharply divided feelings about his parents and some tenacious features of his scholarly cast of mind. His hatred, which was his own term, for his father's irascible temperament, was an important factor in his development of a strongly rationalistic outlook, which manifests itself in the methodological self-control and analytical rigor of all his work, while his abiding love for his mother was accompanied by a desire to emulate her unwavering commitment to truth-telling, a commitment which is obviously pertinent to the sometimes startling frankness of marginal comment itself. Personal professional interplay on a different level can be seen in the lasting effects of Dover's precocious attraction, even when still a young teenager, to the grammar of exotic languages, in particular Melanesian languages. An attraction which helped to induce in him a contrasting pair of lifelong tendencies in his work. On one hand, a liking for rigorous taxonomic clarity, but on the other hand, a strong awareness of the play of autonomy, as opposed to the sway of universal grammar, in the workings of individual languages. Different again is the axis from the personal to the scholarly in Dover's work on Greek popular morality, where the autobiography underlines something that's already explicit in the 1974 book on that subject, namely that his attempt to make sense of Greek morality was partly shaped by his attempt to make sense of the moral values and conflicts in his own world and in his own life. He spells that out. He starts from his own moral convictions and takes them with him, in some sense, into his study of the Greeks, which will strike many people as an odd way to go about things, especially for a very rigorous scholar. And a final example, Dover's wartime experience demonstrably impinged on his later scholarship, both in his understanding of Thucydides, particularly Thucydides' depiction of the psychology of armies at moments of intense pressure and crisis, but also, very differently, his appreciation of Aristophanes' comic depiction of non- or even anti-intellectual forms of speech and behaviour. Dover was very explicit that it was because of the barely educated soldiers he commanded during the war that he developed an insight into the character of many Aristophanic protagonists. Again, an odd point of view. Well, those are just a few of the connecting, I think, the connecting and entangling threads between life and work that are visible in marginal comment. Marginal comment makes visible. But it's worth adding an observation from a different angle, and one which gives the book a somewhat paradoxical status in relation to the title of this colloquium, Hellenists' Memoirs. In a way, this is, I think, the most important point I want to make. Dover's concern to embed his professional work fully within the framework of his life as a whole goes hand in hand with a refusal to allow his memoir to serve as a manifesto for Greek studies. So in that sense, one can argue about whether it's a Hellenist memoir at all. Marginal comment authentically reflects, in fact, his lifelong aversion to placing Greek antiquity on an idealized pedestal or to attaching some kind of unique significance to its legacy, as opposed to seeing its study as an equal partner alongside the rest of the humanities. And in this respect, I think Dover differed radically from many high-profile Hellenists, including, I would say, Murray, Dobbs, and Bowler, Hellenists both of his own generation and of the generation before his, for whom ancient Greek culture continued to carry a privileged status as a canonical model of humanistic values. Dover's reluctance to subscribe to such ways of thinking makes a consistent difference to the way he presents both himself and his subject. His own academic interests are summarized, for sure, in the memoir, in their individual contexts, but they're shown to have developed not from some overarching conception of Hellenism, but from a series of contingently evolving circumstances and opportunities. And correspondingly, he has very little to say by way of commentary on the trends and changes in the study of Greek antiquity, which took place over the course of his career in the second half of the 20th century. Despite those qualifications on the idea of marginal comment as a Hellenist memoir, the book does nonetheless allow one, I think, to discern a powerful underlying consistency of mentality and principle between Dover the scholar and Dover the autobiographer. This was a point rightly stressed by some of the work's classicist reviewers, including Bernard Knox in the Times Literary Supplement and Peter Jones in the Sunday Telegraph. To grasp what's at stake here, one needs to be clear about the core of Dover's self-understanding as a scholar and of his conception of the humanities in general. Although Dover worked on many Greek authors, genres, and topics, of course, he always thought of himself as fundamentally a historian. Not for nothing did he give the penultimate chapter of his memoir the title A History Man. But this doesn't mean that he specifically rated his work on historiography, and above all, his major contribution to completion of Gong's historical commentary on Thucydides, as more important than his work on comedy, oratory, popular morality, homosexuality, or the stylistics of Greek literature. No, he didn't. But he regarded all scholarship in the humanities as intrinsically a form of history, namely the investigation and reconstruction of the contingent particulars of the past through collection, analysis, and interpretation of all available evidence. As regards his own scholarship, this conviction was combined with his self-description, and quoting now from the memoir, as an Anglo-Saxon empiricist, hospitable to ideas, but hostile to any theory which boasts of its own comprehensive power. That is indeed a quotation from that penultimate chapter called The History Man. Finally, and crucially, Dover believed in what he called smooth continuity between historical inquiry and everyday life. In other words, we're doing history in relation to ourselves all the time. The sort of swimming in the sea of history in our own lives. One telling illustration of this, I think, in practice, was the dossier Dover compiled in early 1981 of all the material he could access relating to the acrimonious and protracted debate which had divided the British Academy under Dover's presidency over the fellowship of Anthony Blunt, who had been unmasked as a Russian spy by Margaret Thatcher in Parliament in late 1979. Dover explicitly thought of this dossier, which included summaries of all the conversations he was privy to on the subject, a little bit like the speeches in Thucydides, as a quasi-Thucydidean project applied to events he'd lived through himself. So it wasn't a war, it wasn't a matter of life and death, it was, you know, the nearest thing that an argument in the British Academy. Given the strongly held convictions about history I've just outlined, convictions which crop up all over the place in Dover's scholarship as well as in the memoir, Dover was necessarily committed to understanding autobiography itself in these same terms, as an exercise in the empirically controlled investigation and reconstruction much subject to the principles of historical inquiry. Yes, the memoirist has supposedly privileged access to certain kinds of information, and equally, at the same time, as I think Daisy mentioned, the autobiographer is implicated in special risks of both error and bias. But these elements are no exception for Dover to the fact that all historical interpretation is both provisional and corrigible. You get bias and error of various kinds in history in general. In light of the aversion to theory, which I mentioned a moment ago, and theory for Dover includes most kinds of philosophical thinking as well, it's unsurprising that marginal comment doesn't set out this conception of autobiography or memoir writing in the abstract, but it does put it into practice. One consequence of Dover's stance is that he lacks anything, I think, like Dobbs's puzzlement in missing persons over certain areas and aspects of his own life, let alone an Augustinian sense of being a mystery to himself. Dobbs, I think, I hope we can agree, was much nearer to Augustine on that spectrum. He was puzzled by many things that had been, in some sense, him. Dover, in fact, finds nothing about his past experiences psychologically mysterious, only pragmatically uncertain at particular points. And even his own intermittent interest in Freudian psychology makes no real difference to his adherence to historical inquiry and reasoning as the essential form of human self-understanding. It's Dover's belief that he could treat his own life as an object of historical study with uncensored directness and without neglect of any of the relevant evidence, which goes to the heart of what made marginal comments so controversial on its original publication in November 1994. Controversial above all for what the Times leader on the subject called its shocking candour on the subject of such things as Dover's sexual experiences, his wife's treatment for depression, and most scandalously in the original press reception of the book, Dover's admission that as president of Corpus Christi, Oxford in 1985, he had fervently wished for the death of his troubled and troublesome colleague, Trevor Aston, who committed suicide. Yet there's something inimitably ironic about the idea that an autobiography of all genres should be found shocking on account of its candor. I think Dover himself says somewhere, isn't that the whole point? Shouldn't that be the whole point? And indeed, even that Times leader from which I quoted a moment ago, and which was heavily critical of Dover's book, could not help noticing the irony. Disturbing though it found parts of marginal comment, it did add that its degree of candour, and I'm now quoting again, suggests how contrived most autobiographies probably are. Dover himself, I think, would have taken this concession as a grudging compliment to his own conception of history. Well, I proposed near the start of this talk that there's a basic dichotomy among autobiographers between those who believe that they can, in principle, make sense of their own lives and those who find themselves a retrospective mystery to themselves. Kenneth Dover undoubtedly belonged to the first of these groups, but not, I suggested, because he simply succumbed to the self-deception that T.S. Eliot regarded as an unavoidable hazard of the genre, but rather because he wrote his memoir as the kind of person and scholar that he was, an empiricist historian committed to what he took to be the historian's intrinsic task of truth-seeking and truth-telling. Whatever judgment one might reach on the success or otherwise of his venture, and some of Dover's closest friends, including Donald Russell, thought the marginal comment presented a seriously distorted self-portrait, I'd like to conclude with the thought that the understanding of history which underpins the memoir is itself deeply rooted in Dover's mentality as a Greek scholar. And it's this